Hello, welcome to this session on design of machine elements 2, subject code 18ME62 of VTU. So module number 2, that is design of spur and helical gears. So in this session I'll be discussing on the Lewis equation as applied to the spur gears. Let us see what is the beam strength of gear tooth. It's also known as the Lewis equation. So the analysis of the bending stresses in the gear tooth was done by the person called Lewis in his paper The Investigation of the Strength of Gear Tooth, which was submitted in the year 1892. So this expression is used till today in the design of the gears. So in his analysis, Lewis treated the gear tooth as a cantilever beam as shown in the figure. So as we know that the resultant force acting on the tooth of the gear is basically resolved into two components. One is the tangential force, which is responsible for transmitting the torque, and the other is the radial component, which is nothing but the separating force. So here the useful force is nothing but the tangential force, that is denoted by Ft. So here the force Ft is shown acting on the tooth here. So there are certain assumptions that we have to make before we go for the equation. So this is basically based upon the following assumptions. First of all, the effect of the radial component, which is denoted by Fr, so which actually induces the compressive stresses in the tooth, is neglected because its magnitude will be relatively small. It's a separating force, it is neglected. And then it is assumed that the tangential force Ft is uniformly distributed over the face width of the gear tooth as shown in the figure. Next, as the teeth is not straight, it is curved in shape, so there may be a little bit of stress concentration, but the effect of stress concentration is neglected in this particular analysis. Then it is assumed that at any time only one pair of teeth will be in contact and takes the total load, although there may be more than one pair of teeth which may be in contact, but here it is safe to assume that only one pair of teeth takes the total load. So it can be seen from the figure that the cross section of the tooth varies from the free end to the fixed end. So we know that the force acting on the tooth is resolved into two components, the tangential component Ft and the radial component Fr. So the critical section, or the section of maximum bending stress, is nothing but the section XX because of the tangential force Ft. So it is subjected to, the teeth is subjected to bending, and the maximum bending stress occurs at the section XX. So for the purpose of analysis, we construct a parabola inside the tooth profile as shown in the figure by dashed lines. So which will be tangent to this base of the tooth at the section XX. So this parabola represents a beam of uniform strength. Means if the teeth are shaped like a parabola, then it will have the same stress at all the sections. So this is the advantage of taking the beam tooth as a parabolic beam, and we take the forces acting onto this parabolic beam, as can be seen from the figure. So this height of this parabolic beam is taken as h, and ft is taken to be acting at the end of this parabolic beam, and fr will be the compressive force. So the maximum value of the bending stress at the base of the tooth or at the section xx can be determined by using the bending equation. So that is given by sigma is equal to m into c over I. So this is from the bending equation. So let us take this as equation number 1, where the m represents the bending moment, so which can be given because the maximum bending moment occurs at the base of the tooth. So that is given by product of the tangential force Ft and the height of the tooth, that is h. And then if we consider the moment of inertia, so if we observe this rectangular cross section, the moment of inertia for this cross section is given by capital I is equal to B into T cube divided by 12, and C, that is the distance from the neutral axis to the extreme fiber, that is given by the expression T by 2, where B represents the face width of the gear tooth and T represents the thickness of the tooth. Now substituting these expressions in equation number 1, we get sigma is equal to Ft into H into T by 2 divided by Bt cube by 12. So simplifying this, we get sigma as 6 Ft H divided by Bt square. From this expression, we can obtain the value expression for Ft as Bt square into sigma over 6 H. So we have the expression for Ft. So in this expression, the variables, that is the thickness T and the tooth height H, are the variables which depend upon the size of the tooth, that is the circular pitch, and also on the profile of the tooth. So let us take the thickness T as x into p, and the height of the tooth h as k into p, where p is the circular pitch and x and k are the constants. So therefore, substituting in the expression for ft in place of t and h, we get the expression ft is equal to b into sigma into x square p square over 6kp. So from this, if we simplify this, we get ft as b sigma into p into x square over 6k. So let us take this term x square by 6k as y, which is another constant. So therefore ft can be written as b into sigma into p into y. So here we can write the circular pitch P as the product of pi into the module. So therefore Ft is equal to B into sigma into pi into m into y. Let's take it as equation number 2. So where here the y, small y, which is given by x square by 6k, this is called as the Lewis form factor. So if we substitute the expressions for x and k, what we are going to get is t square by p square into p divided by 6h. That will give us the expression for y as t square divided by 6hp. So where p is the circular pitch. And it may be noted that if the size of the gear is increased, then the distances like the thickness, the height of the tooth, and in turn the circular pitch also will increase proportionately. Therefore, the value of y will remain unchanged even if these variables increase. And also we can observe that the value of y is independent of the size of the tooth. So it depends only on the number of the teeth on a gear and on the system or profile of the teeth. So the value of Lewis form factor y in terms of the number of teeth may be expressed by these equations in the design data handbook, that is the equation number 12.5c, 12.5d and 12.5e of the design data handbook. So here the design data handbook what we are referring is by authors K. Mahadevan and K. Balavir Reddy, that is the fourth edition book. So for the different profiles for 14.5 degree involute system, we can see y is given by 0.124 minus 0.684 divided by z. And for 20 degree full depth involute system, it is y is equal to 0.154 minus 0.912 divided by z. And for 20 degree stub teeth system, it's given by 0.175 minus 0.95 divided by z. So these are the equations, because here from these equations we can observe that this is completely dependent upon only on the number of teeth. Next, the permissible static bending stress sigma for the gears is modified by using a parameter called velocity factor. It is modified as sigma d into cv. So the velocity factor is denoted by cv. So this is for taking into account the dynamic and fatigue loads. So where sigma d is can be taken from the table number 12.7 of the design data handbook for the given material of the gears. So therefore the Lewis equation, that is the equation number 2, can be rewritten as Ft is equal to, we substitute in place of sigma as sigma d into cv, we get this expression, that is pi into sigma d into cv into b into y into m. So this is given in equation number 12.5a of the design data handbook. So these are the equations from the design data handbook for the Lewis form factor, that is small y. So we have the equations 12.5c, 12.5d and 12.5e for the different profiles of the teeth, that is 14.5 degree, 20 degree full depth involute and 20 degree stub teeth system. Beam strength of the gear teeth. So we have from the Lewis equation, the Ft is given by b into sigma into pi m into y. So let us represent a term, that is capital Y is equal to pi into small y. So this capital Y is called the form factor, which is nothing but pi into small y. So if we substitute this, then this equation becomes Ft is equal to b into sigma into m into capital Y. So from the Lewis equation we can observe, if the magnitude of the tangential force increases, then the bending stress will also increase correspondingly. So when the stress reaches the permissible or allowable magnitude of the bending stresses, then the corresponding force or the FT is called as the beam strength. Or in other words, the maximum value of the tangential force that the tooth can transmit without bending failure. So that is called as the beam strength. So it is indicated by S suffix B. So when this FT reaches the maximum value of the bending strength that is permitted, then it is called as the beam strength. So in order to avoid the breakage of the gear tooth due to bending, so the beam strength should always be more than the effective force between the two meshing teeth. So in the design of the gears, it is always required to decide the weaker member between the two gears, that is between the pinion and the gear. So we have the Lewis equation, Ft is equal to B into sigma into pi into M into Y. So from this equation, we can observe that the variables M and B will be the same for the pinion and the gear. So in a given pair of gears. So when the different materials are used, then we can see from this equation, it is the product of sigma and Y that decides the weaker member between the pinion and the gear. And we can also observe that since the pinion is smaller in size, so the Lewis form factor will always be lesser for the pinion when compared to the gear. So therefore, when the same material is used for both the pinion and the gear, the pinion will always be weaker than the gear. But when the materials used are different, then the product sigma into Y decides the which one is the weaker member.